Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. And before we begin, can I remind all members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Apologies have been received from Karen Adam this morning, and we understand that Emma Harper will be joining us as her substitute after 10 a.m. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 6 in private. Are we agreed? We're agreed. Our second item of business this morning is consideration of the draft Plant Health Fees Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022 and the consent notification for the Official Controls Plant Health Frequency Checks Regulation 2022. And I welcome to the meeting the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity and the Scottish Government officials Rachel Coutts and Caspian Richards. And I invite the Minister to make any opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for making time today to consider the draft SSI, the Plant Health Fees Miscellaneous Amendment, Scotland Regulations 2022. The regulations are being made to amend Scottish legislation in the field of plant health, in particular relating to fees payable by an importer of a consignment originating in a third country in respect of the physical and identity checks of plant and plant products. The import fees are being amended as a consequence of a new GB-focused risk-based frequency of checks regime being introduced across GB from the 22nd of July 2022. The new methodology is set out in the statutory instrument PH/038, which the committee has just considered. The revised fees apply to imported consignments of all high-risk products imported from all third countries, as well as lower-risk regulated products from all third countries except the EU, Liechtenstein and Switzerland. In addition, the regulations also amend the Plant Health Fees Forestry, England and Scotland Regulations of 2015. The forestry fees regulations contain provision relating to export certification fees for forestry products under the UK Government's Movement Assistance Scheme to provide that such fees are not payable in relation to exports from Scotland to Northern Ireland in certain circumstances. The Movement Assistance Scheme was originally scheduled to end in December 2022, but the UK Government later extended the scheme and it is now due to end in December 2023. The 2022 regulations amend the forestry fees regulations to reflect this later date. These regulations are therefore necessary and appropriate. My officials and I would be happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you very much. And we do have a number of questions. According to the notification, the new approach is based on the EU principles for risk-targeted inspections. So can I ask why the Scottish Government feels a new approach is required and what the deficiencies were in the existing approach?
I will give you my layperson's interpretation and officials can come in with technical details if I've missed anything. Due to Brexit, it is now necessary to check do these checks on all high-risk products coming from the EU in addition to the rest of the world. So these checks aim to bring how we treat products from the EU into alignment with how we do the rest of the world. Obviously, you know, the Scottish Government didn't wish for Brexit to happen, didn't wish for these checks to be necessary, but it is important that we have alignment between how we handle products from the EU and how we handle the products from the rest of the world. England and Wales have already put in place such a risk-based scheme. The EU scheme, which of course is what would have checked these products as they came into the EU, is also a risk-based scheme. So it is the same principle and the same structure of scheme, it's just that we have to now bring this into Scottish legislation.
Okay, but what were the deficiencies in the current scheme that require you to bring in a new approach?
It isn't a matter of deficiencies in the existing scheme. The EU scheme was based on risks for the EU. Now that we're bringing this legislation at a GB level, and of course the fees are related to Scotland, but the SI is at a GB level. When we do that risk assessment, although the methodology for the risk assessment is very similar, of course, risks that we face in the GB are different than the risks that are faced by the EU. For example, in the EU, there are many citrus growers. We don't grow citrus fruits in the UK. So the risk assessment on those things would be different. So it isn't a matter of deficiencies. It is a matter of doing appropriate checks for the risks that we have here.
Okay, thank you. Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. Could the Minister explain to us what the EU principles for risk-targeted inspections are and how they're reflected in the new proposed inspection regime?
Again, I'll give you the sort of layperson's view, and officials can come in with the details. It's the same kind of risk profiling. So when we have pathogens that exist, we have to check that as plants come in that they are that is the correct plant as identified, and that that plant is healthy, is not bringing pathogens in. So based on, you know, risk assessments would be based on what we grow here, what pathogens may, you know, spread in the UK, and what might put risk to our crops and our commercial interests. I don't know if officials have more detail they'd like to add.
I think that's basically the assessment. It's the EU approach. It's based on a frequency of checks at 100% for goods, which can be reduced where those are considered to be at a lower risk, and that's the same principle that sort of applies to the approach that's been developed on a GB-wide basis. But as the Minister said, with reflecting the risks within a GB context in terms of the specific goods.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've set out some of the reasoning here, but I just wondered if you could give a practical example of the new process that we're talking about and how the GB approach would differ from the EU approach. You've given your reasons for your own approach, but I wonder, can you give a practical example from real life?
Yeah, so the citrus fruits is the practical example I can give. Obviously, officials can give more. We don't grow citrus fruits in the UK. We don't have a commercial interest there or grow crops. So importing citrus plants, for example, wouldn't risk our commercial agriculture. So those would be considered a lower risk product, whereas products that we do grow here that are part of our commercial agriculture, those would be higher risk products. So we don't need the same level of checks on, for example, citrus plants that a country would grow those things as a commercial product.
The other point I wanted to raise was, or just to ask you about briefly, was Annex 2 to the notification sets out the issue of frequency of checks. So, for instance, it's proposed that there'll be a check at a frequency of 30% for some categories. I wonder if you could maybe just explain why this is the case and what the reason was behind that figure.
So, I mean, any particular figure, I'll need to get officials to go in, but the principle of the matter is to understand the risks of where things are coming from. So, for example, if we're importing from a country that we know has good plant health controls, that we know it isn't particularly infected by a pathogen, say, that affects, you know, barley or something of that kind, then we wouldn't do those inspections. But if a plant is coming or plant material is coming from a country that we know contains that pathogen, that doesn't have the standards of plant health checks and inspections that we would expect to have, then we, of course, need to increase our inspections to ensure our biosecurity.
Thank you, Convener.
Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I mean, it's quite a complicated subject, isn't it? So I was wondering why the frequency rates have been set at, for example, 30% for a check, rather than the standardised rates, which were 3, 5, 10, 50 and 100%. And also, can you give us some examples of any woody plants that are prohibited to come into the country without that are subject to these checks that may affect agriculture?
I'll let the officials answer the second question, but on the first one, is, as I said to the member, it depends on where items are coming from. So if items are coming from a country that has good plant health security, that isn't affected by a known pathogen, then we can safely reduce the levels of checks. If plant material is coming from a country where we know they carry a pathogen, there's a risk there to our crops, then we would increase the level of checks. So it allows us to be flexible and dynamic and use our resources to prevent those higher risks. On the second question, maybe officials can give some examples for me.
I think you'd have to offer to write with a kind of specific example of the woody plants. Basically, the principle in terms of plants for planting is that those are the higher risk goods because they are sort of there's soil material involved. In terms of a kind of specific example of a woody plant that for under that category, then we'd have to sort of follow up with writing on that one.
Okay. Obviously, it's important that This is a slight change, I would say. I'm not convinced from your answer to the convener's question that this is a sort of a like-for-like approach that we're taking, as it was. I would like reassurance that was. Do you have examples of any... I mean, what level of plant is getting into this country? I noticed that, you know, there are some people that might bring something in the country in their hand luggage. And, like, are these just checks that are happening in... large in lorries, or are they random checks? Are they planned entries into the country? How does this work?
Yeah, that's why I'll give you a general overview, and then officials can come in with more detail. So this SI and the fees relate to only high risk products. So that is commercially importing large quantities through commercial and through for business interests. That one plant in your hand luggage is not a high risk product. That's low risk, and checks on low risk have been delayed by another 18 months. So this legislation is specifically about high risk. So yeah, it is those commercial things. It is imports that we know about that we can then trace through the country. It's making sure those are right. And of course, we can check up to 100% of those. In fact, the default fee is for 100% check, but we are able to, so for example, as Caspian says, if for woody products that maybe had a very high risk to them, we could do up to 100% checks because we can trace those materials. Where there is a lower risk, then we can lower the number of checks just based on that risk assessment. I don't know if officials want to add anything there.
Yes, so if coming back to what you were saying about how does it work, and it is quite complex. There is our model for checking these goods, so SPS goods, is based on the Official Controls Regulation, which is the EU model. So there's the EU model, and then we have now the Official Controls Regulation for GB, which was deficiency fixed at the when we left the EU. And as a part of the Official Controls Regulation, competent authorities, so from Scottish ministers, are required to undertake risk-based checks on specific goods which are listed for plants. There are lists of these plants which must undergo checks. Importers are required to let, and to kind of, just to kind of go into how it kind of works on the ground, importers are required to give advance notice to the Scottish ministers that they intend to import these goods, and at that point they will be randomly selected, or if they're at 100% check, all of the goods will be selected, and that will be undertaken by government officials, and at that point it's all done electronically, and fees are paid. The frequency of checks and the fees that we are putting in place is based on this overarching EU model, and we, as the Minister has said, this is now adapted for GB and has tailored it to a GB context, and the legislation reflects a lot of what was in the EU legislation and slightly goes into a little bit more detail. In fact, it does things like it requires the government to publish frequency rates online, which is something that the EU model doesn't set out in legislation but happens in practice. So that's kind of some of the slight differences. So I think it's important to remember we're still under this EU model, but it's tailored following requirements under the Official Controls Regulation.
Okay, thank you. Just to follow up with Mr. Richards, when you get back with regards to any sort of non-native species that are a risk to agriculture, I mean, it's important that, you know, with all the new competences that we may have with regards to controlling any non-native species, say on the upland, say for example bracken that needs to be controlled for tick populations with azulum, you know, it's important that that these types of products are not coming into the country to affect, I suppose, the spread of ticks and things like that. But anyway. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to clarify something. So it's quite straightforward in terms of an importer will notify through paperwork and electronically what it's importing. So it might be a lorry full of bean seeds, and they're low risk, so they may only get checked at 3%. It could be potatoes, and they may be checked at 50% because they're higher risk. So why is it that some of the product, plant products in Annex 2 are proposed to be checked at 30%, because that's not one of the standard five frequencies, which are 3, 5, 10, 15, 100. Why on earth is there some that are checked at 30%?
I'll hand to officials on that one.
I,
I don't know the answer to that. I think that may be an error. I think we may have to clarify why the 30% is there, or if it has been missed out of the, if 30% is a standard inspection frequency. So if it's all right, convener, we'll clarify on that.
Yes, certainly, because it appears strange that if there's five set frequencies, there's some plants that don't fit in with that criteria. Okay, Jim Fairley.
Minister, can you just outline to us, are there any other ways in which the approach to determining the frequency of checks differs to that of the EU? For example, the default frequency in the GB, will it continue to be 100% unless a commodity qualifies for the lower frequency of checks?
That is my understanding that that's
the
case.
I should understand. Will the proposed SI continue to prescribe that those commodities where more than 1% of the consignments are found to have harmful organisms are not eligible for reduced frequency of checks?
That is my understanding.
Yeah. And whether the GB approach continues to prescribe a minimum number of consignments that must have been imported in the GB in order to qualify for reduced frequency of checks, and if so, what these minimum numbers of consignments are?
I don't know the answer to that one.
It's the minimum is 40. That is a change from the EU. The EU was 200, but that is just to reflect the smaller market, as it were. So there will be a requirement to have 40 consignments in order to be eligible.
So the EU is 200, but the UK SI is reducing it to 40 on the basis of the numbers of products that are coming in. Okay, thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
I think the Minister's answered my questions in response to other members' questions, so it might be appropriate just to move on.
Okay. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Can I ask how the proposed SI relates to the common framework on plant health? For example, is this decision-making fora and processes established by the common framework being used in relation to import checks on plant products? And will they be used in relation to the annual review of frequency of checks?
I will refer to officials for that one.
So the common framework sets out how the administrations across the UK work together on a range of plant health issues. It's very much describing the processes which are in place to work to identify threats to plant health, and part of that is are the forums through which the risk-based assessments on take place for that then apply to the fees legislation. So it's very much part of that overall sort of UK-wide framework. So it's sort of officials from the four administrations who are making these sort of assessments based on the risks within a GB context.
Okay, so the framework work informs how these SIs are designed.
Yeah, well, it describes the processes where we work together to develop to develop things like the legislation in common, but also the assessment of the risks of within a GB context.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Jenny Mintel.
Thank you, Minister, and your team. I wonder if you could let us know what the Scottish Government's role in the annual review of frequency rates is, and also how the Scottish Parliament will be able to scrutinise these decisions which will impact on imports to Scotland.
Thank you. I'm sure the answer to the first question is in the frameworks that Caspian has just described. Those frameworks describe how we work together with the four nations of the UK. In terms of how Parliament may scrutinise, I'm not sure what the instrument there is.
Again, as it's based on the EU model, what will happen is that the UK Plant Health Services, so that's all the devolved administrations, will work together to establish those frequencies. It's not expected that there is any parliamentary scrutiny for those frequencies. That's exactly the same as what happened with the EU previously. EU had legislation and then annually would produce a notification which set out the frequencies. So it's doing the same. So it's not expected, as this is a business as usual step, that it is not expected there would be any parliamentary scrutiny at that point for those fee levels.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm just going to go back to response, Mr. Richard, on the question about common frameworks. The notification actually states that the SI is not related to a common framework.
I'm not sure about that, to be honest. So the common frameworks there is a common framework for plant health, and that describes how the administrations sort of work together across the piece. It's not derived from the common framework. So I guess it's but the common framework describes the processes through which the administrations work together. So I guess it's complementary from that point of view. But it's not that the common framework has produced this legislation.
Okay.
I think it's important to say that the plant health framework's not yet been approved or scrutinised, so I think that's why it says it doesn't refer to a plant health framework. But obviously there are structures that are already in place that we are using to make these decisions that we would hope would go forward and in the future be part of the framework.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. And finally, can I just ask why there is a reduced fee per consignment proposed for those imports eligible for a reduced level of physical checks? Why would that?
So the fees structure is intended to just cover the costs. So where there are reduced inspections required, that's of course reduced costs. So the fees are not a money-making mechanism. If we have to spend less resources doing fewer checks, then we don't need to charge as much fees.
But it's the fees based on, it's a consignment fee, not a overall fee. So why would the cost per consignment be less because there's fewer?
That's an excellent question. So if you were one of the 3% chosen to have your truck full of potatoes checked, it would be unfair for you to have to pay the fee because that is just done randomly. So those costs are spread around the sector. So for each individual consignment, that is spread across the whole sector so that those fees are fair, so that the person whose individual consignment is chosen is not unfairly penalised.
Okay, thank you. And just finally going back to what may be a drafting error, it would be useful to know whether that drafting error relating to the 30% frequency is in the UK draft. And, you know, before we can give consent, can you let us know whether how that would be addressed? Because ultimately, this went into legislation, the 30% would stand. How would that be rectified if it's a drafting error?
Obviously, what's in the notification has been taken from information that we've received from discussed with the our colleagues in the UK government. And I think what I'd like to go back and check is if 30% should be in the paragraph in the notification. And I suspect that's where the error has arisen, or in fact, the 30% is a typo in the annex and it should read 50 or 100, but certainly I'll confirm where the issue is if it's either in the content of the notification or in the annex.
Okay, that's fine, thank you. Is there any further questions? No, okay. We'll now move on to consideration of the instruments. Agenda item 3, so we'll first move to the consent notification. Do members have any comments on the notification, and do we agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notification being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Agreed. Thank you. Agenda item 4, which is the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument, and I invite the Minister to move motion S6M-04876. That the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee recommends that the Plant Health Fee Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulation 2022 draft be approved.
I'm happy to move the motion.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? Okay, we now move to the question. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? Thank you. Approved. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report on our deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. And that completes consideration of the subordinate legislation. And I thank the Minister and our officials for attending today. And I will briefly suspend to allow change over witnesses and will reconvene at 9:35. Thank you. And we now turn to evidence on the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Bill, and a welcome to our meeting, our first panel, who will focus on the animal welfare perspectives. So, attending remotely, we have Pete Goddard from the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, who's substituting for Libby Anderson, who is not able to be with us. And also remotely, we have Robbie Marsland from the League Against Cruel Sports. In the room with us, we have Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, and Kirsty Jenkins from One Kind. So we have got a series of questions, probably going to take us up to around about 11 o'clock. And I'll kick off and could ask witnesses what their overall views are on the bill. And we'll kick off with Mike Flynn.
We strongly welcome the bill. I think it's fair to say if everybody had acted in accordance and with the intent of the 2002 Act, we wouldn't be sitting here today. But the majority of it is to close the loopholes that were there, because from our point of view, every badger baiter has been after foxes, every hare courser has been after rabbits. So there's a lot in this bill that we strongly, strongly welcome. But I think a lot of things have got to be defined better, because there's still a lot open to interpretation when it gets to courts. And I think the licensing provisions have got to be really specified and fleshed out if Nature Scotland are going to have a reasonable chance of doing a good licensing job. Thank you.
OK, thank you. And we'll now move to remotely to Robbie Marsland.
I agree with Mike. We strongly welcome the intent behind the bill and have some interests and concerns about exceptions, and particularly to the licensing scheme, which I'm sure we'll be exploring more in this session today.
Okay, thank you. Kirsty Jenkins.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you all for inviting us here today. We also support the bill. The aim of the bill was to address some of the discrepancies and close loopholes in the 2002 Act, and I think it does achieve that to a large extent. We do have some concerns about some of the exceptions and the licensing scheme, and I'm sure we'll get to the details of that as we go along. We would also like to question the assumptions behind those exceptions, which are that foxes need to be killed routinely and that the use of dogs is a suitable way to do that. I know that several of you represent farmers, and I know that lamb losses has been a big topic of discussion. And I think that farmers definitely need to be better supported, both financially and in terms of their mental health. That's a big conversation that's not going to happen today, but I think it is relevant and I wanted to acknowledge it. And farmers also need to be supported in terms of any changes to wildlife management. So I want to say that, because any suggestions I make for changes, I'm not implying that the onus for that should be on any individuals. It needs to be government-led, and farmers should be supported. But it does seem that if we do not have enough methods to control wild animals, to manage wild animals that are both effective and humane, then that is a problem that needs to be addressed. But I don't think it means that we should just carry on doing what we're doing. So coming back to this bill, we strongly support the bill. We do have concerns about the exceptions. We'd prefer to see no exceptions at all. If they're going to remain, we think there are ways they could be strengthened. And I'm sure we'll get to the details of that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Pete Goddard.
Well, good morning. Thank you very much for the opportunity to attend today. I'm standing in as safe for Libby Anderson, who apologises for not being able to be here. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission is very welcoming of the bill. We see it introducing a much greater clarity in the legislation. There are some small points where I think, the greater clarity and the lack of confusion could be introduced, but in general, this is moving towards sort of questioning practices and looking for solutions that follow international ethical principles for wildlife control, and we are very supportive of it. And as others have said already, yeah, in some of the details we'll pick out later on, that there may be some things which we can add, which we've obviously elucidated in our written contribution. Thank you.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to questions on section 1 and 2 of the bill that cover offences. And I'll first move to Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to direct this question to Robbie, and then if others want to come in. I'd like to ask for some clarification. The written evidence received by the committee includes many statements that the bill will limit the efficacy of so-called pest control. But I thought that the main substance of the bill, the offences in Section 1 and 2, relate to hunting with dogs in circumstances which I believe are already illegal. Could you clarify what do you believe the intention of the bill is, and why is it necessary?
Sure, thank you. The League Against Cruel Sports has been looking at mainly mounted hunts, but activities which include encouraging packs of hounds to chase and kill foxes, both mounted and on foot. And that's where our concern started, because we all thought that fox hunting in that way had been banned in 2022. But when we started to look very carefully at the situation, what we found was that exceptions in the existing legislation, the Protection of Wild Mammals Act, were being used in a way to enable what you could describe as traditional hunting to continue in Scotland, specifically the flushing to guns exception. And it was interesting that the main difference between the flushing to guns exception in Scotland to that in England and Wales was that in Scotland it was possible to use a full pack of hounds to go flushing to guns. And when we filmed the majority of the 10 mounted hunts in Scotland in the first season in 2014, you know, we didn't see a single gun. What we thought we were looking at was traditional hunting, which was happening perhaps beneath the radar. So that was the issue that caused the League to start talking about this in public, and that's the issue that we've been trying to address since then. And that's the issue which I'm really pleased that this legislation is looking at. As the Minister said when she introduced the legislation, it's that situation that we're now trying to finally close and to really ban fox hunting in the way that we thought we'd done getting on for 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago. So I very much see this as redressing a failure of the existing law, or the fact that it's just too easy to get around the existing law, and that this bill will bring in and close loopholes, if you like, in the existing legislation. As I mentioned earlier, and again, I'm sure we'll be talking about, my worry is that there may be some new loopholes being introduced in this legislation, and that's the area where I'm particularly interested in, because I think we do know that there are groups of people who are quite determined to use packs of hounds to hunt, chase and kill wild mammals, foxes in Scotland. And I think we need to make sure that this legislation really, really does stop that from happening. It would be awful if we had to all come back in a year's time and look at more film of that kind of activity happening. And that's what I'm hoping won't happen.
Thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that.
Okay. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. One of the things that you may have seen that's been discussed at some length in previous meetings we've had has been about the definition of which wild mammals should be included in this piece of legislation. There's been quite a lot of discussion in the committee about rabbits specifically, but I wonder if you could... just looking firstly at perhaps Mike Flynn and Robbie Marsland, whether you could offer an opinion about that, and whether the inclusion of the the inclusion of rabbits in the bill is needed and works?
The Scottish SPCA welcomes rabbits being included. As I said in my opening part, that is the usual excuse for people that the police catch when they're hare coursing, is that they're after rabbits. And I do understand or believe that BASC of the British Association of Sport and Conservation have said that the majority of rabbits are shot. And shooting would always be the preferred method by a licensed person who's competent to do so.
And just before I move on to other witnesses there, I just wonder, could you indicate, Mr Flynn, is hare coursing, in your view, still a problem in Scotland?
It still goes on, without doubt. I mean, that's a better question for Police Scotland, who can police monitor that, but it's like all kind of rural crime, it's incredibly hard to catch. We've given farmers warnings with the rural police, Alan Drawn, that they should be reporting anybody on their land that is suspicious in any way, whether it's for foxes or rabbits or hares or whatever, because a lot of these people do go on to carry out other crimes on the farm. And I don't know if he's been invited as a witness in this session on police matters, but Alan Drawn would be able to expand on that from the Rural Crime Department.
Thank you. And do others wish to come in? I suggested Robbie Marsland, but perhaps others do as well.
Thank you. I think I'm unmuted. Yeah, I agree with Mike. The problem with we have policing by consent in Scotland and that's always a problem when you come into contact with a group of people who don't consent and who look for excuses and cover. And so when I see the issue of rabbits as an issue in this debate, I do, like Mike, come at it as a way of, oh, is that going to be used as an excuse? Oh, we weren't really chasing foxes, we were chasing rabbits. We weren't really engaged in badger baiting, we were looking for rabbits. And I'm afraid that's the sort of situation that we face ourselves in. And I know, talking to colleagues in Badgers Scotland, that they have lots of concerns about sort of false alibis, if you like, being put forward about it was rabbits that we were looking for. So that's why I would agree with Mike that it's a really good thing that rabbits are included in this, and I'm afraid that's the reason.
Sorry, can I come in on a supplementary? This is one of the most contentious parts, and it would appear that it's using a law to control something in almost in a tangential way, so that, you know, bringing rabbits to stop hares being hunted. Is it not a simpler way not to be, if someone is approached and detained by the police for suspected hare coursing, if the landowner didn't give consent for that person to be on that property with dogs and they were hunting in some way, that would be the way to stop it, rather than using another excuse to catch them for hare coursing. So it seems to be a bit contrived, and it's important. And we've seen in the past where, when the law wasn't particularly precise, it wasn't good law. Is there a danger here we create bad law by bringing in hunting for rabbits as an offence, when actually there'd be other ways to do it? And if landowners are not given consent for people with dogs hunting to be on their property, that would be the most straightforward and easy way to do it, rather than the what appears to be a sledgehammer to crack a nut and bringing rabbits into the legislation. Mike.
Yeah, I can take the point where you're coming from, but this legislation does not stop a farmer controlling rabbits in his land. You can shoot them, they can go ferret and all that kind of stuff, so it's not taking that away. And if you look at one of the biggest a benefit of foxes is the amount of rabbits that they take. So we do welcome that. And again, you're chasing a mammal if the intention is genuinely to go for rabbits, there are other more humane ways to do it than setting dogs on them. A lot of people think that all these kind of activities, the dog instantly kills the animal. Now, you might get away with that with mice and rats, but that's not the most... It's definitely not the case with foxes, but even with rabbits, they're not all instantly killed and they go through the fear of being chased. So if this bill actually said a farmer cannot control a pest on his land, we'd be the first to be concerned about it, because farmers have got to have the right to protect their livestock. I mean, you've got Emma Harper there that brought in legislation to strengthen worrying the livestock. A farmer has got to be able to protect his livelihood. But this, in effect, does not stop that. They can still take legal methods to do it, which, in our opinion, are far more humane.
Rachel Hamilton.
Interesting point you bring up there about the bill that we passed in the Parliament with worrying with livestock. How many people have been charged with that offence? And also, do you have any detail that you can give the committee regarding anyone that's hare coursing that's using rabbits as defence and actually has got away with it? And how many prosecutions are there in terms of hare coursing in Scotland per annum?
As I said earlier on, it's actually Police Scotland that enforce that at the moment. All the what is classed as wildlife legislation, strangely enough, we deal with badger baiting because dogs are involved. But it is a regular excuse from what I understand from Police Scotland that if they're caught suspected of hare coursing, it was rabbits they were after, or some other, at the moment, legal pests to go there. The livestock worrying is highly, I think, as the consultation showed that Emma Harper conducted a year or so ago, is highly underreported. There is a call out in the Pentlands at the moment because there's been a couple of incidents where no person was caught. But as opposed to somebody going out to deliberately hunt a wild mammal, a lot of the livestock we're in is done by people that did not have that intention. And that's why it's back to the access code and encouraging people to be responsible. If they see livestock, they should have their dog under control. And I see under control is in this bill as well. And having a dog under control when it's on, it's been trained to go for a scent or attack an animal, in my opinion, unless you've got physical restraint of it, is damn near impossible.
Can I just follow that up? So do you believe then that domestic offences are different to an offence that is a kind of a commercial livestock control? Can you explain how you would sort of define the difference between both of those in the context of what you've just said?
Well, and it's strange because the suffering that's involved for an animal that is attacked by a dog is the same. They're all sentient beings. They are all going to suffer. But the law seems to look at it differently. I mean, back to the livestock protection, that was bringing it into a kind of modern-day penalties that are available, because the penalties before were absolutely woeful. And there was no encouragement for farmers to report that kind of activity. But if anybody's intentionally doing it, it doesn't matter if it's involving domestic. I mean, if someone was to set hounds on a domestic cat or another dog, they would more than likely be jailed or very heavily fined, but it's acceptable to do it to certain wild animals. That's the bit. The suffering is the same. It's that level of suffering. Whatever a fox that's caught by a dog suffers would be the exact same as if a cat caught it, but you'd have a bigger public outcry. It's just people's different opinions of how wildlife and that should be treated. And wildlife should be treated with respect. And I've not, the Scottish SPCA has not got a problem with anybody humanely destroying an animal that is a pest for them. If it's public health, if it's costing farmers money, identify the problem and deal with it in the most humane manner.
Mr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I just wondered if perhaps the other members of the panel can comment on the point that's just been covered by Mike Flynn there around, firstly, pest control, and secondly, perhaps more generally, their view on the workability of the bill in this area. We have heard a discussion in previous panels about, for instance, are there any unintended consequences in the legislation around dogs that slip their leads and chase after rabbits and so on. I'd just be keen to get a general view, firstly, as I say, whether the others on the panel accept this point that's been made about the need for pest control, and also about the workability of the bill in this area around rabbits.
I think Robbie indicated he wished to come in on that.
I I didn't, oh. but I will. But I will. The issue of pest control again is going to come up and come up throughout this debate, which as I've said, from my eyes, is a debate about stopping people from encouraging packs of hounds to chase and kill wild animals across the Scottish countryside. What I think I have to acknowledge about the bill that we have in front of us is that it does provide the opportunity for people to get a licence if it's shown that the only way that they control animals is by using a pack of hounds to search and to flush to waiting guns. Now, do I agree with that? As I've said before, I'm worried that it provides a loophole. But it's not because I don't think that there aren't situations where you need to control animals. But I think we'll hear from my colleague at Wonkind that the way you make those decisions is one of the most important things, and that's a sort of separate debate about the way you make those decisions. So pest control, yes, it has a role in this debate, but it still takes it away from what it is that this law is trying to do to stop people from encouraging packs of hounds to chase and kill wild animals, and particularly foxes. But as I say, I'm sure colleagues from Wonkind could expand much better than I on that.
I'd like to respond.
Yes, thank you, Convener. We were very glad to see that the word pest was removed from the text of this bill. Unfortunately, it does seem to have remained in the discussions around the bill. As Robbie just alluded to, we, and I think most of you are aware at this point, we sort of support the introduction of the ethical principles for wildlife control. And the final one of those principles is to avoid labels such as pest. However, we do recognise that wild animals do need to be managed for the purposes laid out in this bill. The ethical principles do not prevent that in any way. All they do is provide a way to guide the decision making as to when and how that should happen. And I think that they could be used to strengthen this bill. I just wanted to go to your other point. You mentioned the possibility of a dog slipping a lead and whether that would be, you know, get people breaking the law. And, you know, I don't see that being a problem because the wording of the bill is hunting a mammal using a dog. I believe in the scenario that you outlined, they wouldn't be using a dog. So to me, there doesn't seem to be a problem there with unintended consequences.
Okay, Pete Goddard.
Yes, okay. Thank you. Yes, I think the important thing is that from the Animal Welfare Commission perspective, we would recognise, as others have said, the importance of managing animals which have this sort of negative term pest applied, and equally we're pleased not to see the word pest in the bill. But this isn't saying that we don't recognise the need for ethical wildlife management methods, but those often begin with modifying human practices and then making a justification for using them, using the most appropriate methods. So, yes, I think it's clear to, as Robbie Marsland has said, to have the purpose of the bill in mind when looking at the detail within it. Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. There's just a couple of points of clarification. Kirsty, from yourself, Robbie, and potentially Pete, Mike, you've already answered. Do all of you accept that predator control, and I'm going to use the word pest, because if you're an arable farmer and you're getting 10 acres of arable barley eaten by rabbits, that's a pest to you. Do you all accept that there is a need for our ability to be able to farm in this country requires a degree of ethical control of wild animals? Kirsty, and I don't need a huge explanation, just do you agree in the principle that we should be able to control them?
I agree that there is a need for wild animal management, yes. I don't necessarily agree that it needs to continue in the way that it has historically and is currently being done.
Okay.
And I think that the ethical principles that I've mentioned could help guide that decision-making as to whether it's appropriate to continue using the same methods or whether we should be looking for other methods.
Okay. I'll stick with you just now, if that's okay, convener? All right. In terms of one of the things you said earlier on, you talked about how we gauge whether an animal is a nuisance, if that feels more comfortable for you. And please don't take that as a derogatory. I don't mean that at all. How do you gauge if a fox is a nuisance to you if you're a sheep farmer? How would you gauge that fox is causing you a problem?
I think, I mean, the word pest or nuisance, I mean, any animal could be considered that way. It depends on the circumstance that they're in.
But
I understand.
Practically, how do you determine whether or not that fox is going to cause you problems? How do you do that?
I think that's a good question, and if we're looking at the ethical principles, evidence would be required, and what that evidence is.
So what would that evidence be?
Would depend. I mean, if you are having, you know, lamb losses, then that would be evidence if you documented that.
Let me clarify then. If you're saying that the only way that a farmer should get a licence is they document the losses that they are incurring every morning at lambing time, they go out and they have to record how many lambs are being killed for an ear or a tail or for feeding a den, would that be the requirement that you would rather see for a farmer to be able to get a licence to deal with a fox?
I think that's one of the forms of evidence. I think the other thing, as I said at the beginning, is that this doesn't necessarily have to all fall onto individuals. I think in one of your previous panels there was a mention of landscape skill and wildlife management, and I think equally some of the evidence base could be broader. I'm sure, you know, neighbouring farms are going to be having the same foxes affecting them potentially. I don't know whether the evidence should be at the level of an individual farmer or not. I mean, I think that's something, you know, that would have to be further discussed.
Yeah, so if we want to do this in the best way possible, a farmer is going to know that he's getting lambs killed and carried because that fox is feeding a den. Then you're into a whole different ball game of what we call ethical pest control or ethical wild animal control, because then you're taking a fox out while it's feeding cubs. So surely we can accept the fact that foxes will kill lambs. We know that they do it. I've had 30 years in sheep farming. I can assure you, every year, foxes will kill lambs. We can't decide which fox in the countryside is making the decision to come in and kill lambs. So surely there has got to be a principle of general understanding that foxes will be a problem for farmers lambing, and that the numbers controlled during the winter will be a far more sensible way of doing that rather than wait until the lambs are being killed.
I worked directly with animals for most of my life, and I really do understand how devastating it is when any animal under your care dies. Having said that, as far as I understand it, the evidence is that lamb losses due to predation is actually a very small number overall.
Well, I would dispute that.
Okay.
Having 30 years in sheep farming, I would dispute that.
Okay. Well, and again, we're back to maybe we need a better evidence base, because the evidence I've seen does seem to suggest that. But if that's not the case, then, you know, we need to have a better evidence base.
Well, let me give you an understanding from a sheep farmer's point of view. If you're lambing, and
Jim.
1 second.
Oh, no, please, Jim, please, okay. Decease.
Could I just make one more point?
Yes, certainly.
I just wanted to finish up by saying that Duncan or Ewing from the RSPB spoke about the fact that they do different practices and that doesn't seem to be detrimental to either wild birds or to their farmers who are practicing closer to the ways that we're suggesting with the ethical principles. I don't claim to have all of the evidence. I'm just saying these principles should be followed.
I think we've got those points on record. And we're now going to move on to exceptions, which is section 3, 5, 6 and 7 in the bill, and questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for coming along. I represent Argyll and Bute, which doesn't have any, as far as I'm aware, footpacks or hunts. I'm interested to hear, kind of following on from Mr. Fairley's questions and comments that both Mike Flynn and Kirsty Jenkins has made about understanding that farmers need to protect their livelihoods and their welfare. So I'm interested to hear about your thoughts on the proposals in the bill, which reduce hunting with dogs to no more than two dogs, but also brings in the licence. So if you could, in your answer, perhaps touch on why you are specifically opposing, which I think you've already touched on, the hunting with dogs, but also the thoughts about the limit of two dogs and how that might be interpreted by farmers that I've described. Kirsty, do you want to start?
Well, I think I've already said that, you know, we would prefer to not see any exceptions to this bill. We accept that wild animals need to be managed, but we think that there are different ways to do that. If there are going to be exceptions, I think the two-dog limit means more likelihood that the dogs will stay under control. There'll be less disturbance to other wild animals, less chance of a wild mammal being killed by the dogs. So we support the two-dog limit. I've already mentioned the ethical principles. I'll come back to that. I think that those principles could be applied to the conditions of any of the exceptions. Equally, they could be applied to any licensing scheme. The difference, obviously, just being the level of oversight there. As I said, they don't prevent anything happening, but they guide the decision-making to try and make sure that it's based on evidence and that the level of welfare is prioritised.
Thank you. Mr. Flynn?
you raise some very, very good points there. This bill does not stop a farmer dealing with an animal he perceives to be a pest. It might change the way it's done, it's carried out. And it doesn't matter if it's this legislation or any legislation, nobody likes being told you can't do what you've been doing for 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years. You raised the fact that the point about footpacks and stuff and potentially mounted hunts. There are vast swathes of Scotland that do not have any footpacks or mounted hunts. They still control foxes, and I've not heard screams of anybody from that kind of area saying we must get a footpack in here. So it can be done, and this doesn't stop you dealing with a genuine problem. It's just the way that you're going about it. Reducing the number from 20, well, any number at the moment down to two, is it will guaranteed reduce the chances of the hounds actually catching and killing the fox. And that's what this is intended, because even with the old legislation, it was never the intention to let the hounds kill it. It was the hounds to chase it into an open area to shoot. And I think Mr. Marsden said earlier on, early days of that legislation, there was allegations that there was no even any guns on site. And one of the things I said way back, because I've been here long enough, 20-odd years ago, you cannot get a fox out of cover or out of den and say, run left 100 yards, because that's where the gun is. Foxes, there's a thousand things that will make foxes go in any direction you go. How can the guns safely follow them? So there is that aspect, but there is huge areas of Scotland that do not have the traditional control in using dogs to do it. And this is to stop the use of dogs. And in our point, if that can stop the chances of any dogs killing the animal, as I said, if somebody kills a pest species with a clean shot, you've got no problem from me or the Scottish SPCA.
Thank you. I think Robbie Marsden indicated he wanted to come in.
Thank you. I just wanted to remind ourselves about what Lord Bonamy said, and also a witness in the only successful prosecution of a mounted hunt in Scotland. Lord Bonamy estimated that using a pack of hounds or dogs resulted in the hounds killing the fox in about 20% of the time, which is a pretty high number in terms of if you'll say you're shooting foxes, but in 20% of the occasions, actually, it's the dogs that kill the fox in a fairly horrific way. But also, as I say, in the successful prosecution of the Jed Forrest hunt, one of the defence witnesses who was set to be the person with a gun, his estimate was that 40% of foxes were killed by the pack because he was unable to shoot for one reason or another. So that's one of the reasons why I think it's common sense that if you're using two dogs, that they won't be as good as flushing foxes quicker than if you've got 36 or more. But if you have those 36, then you're somewhere between 20 to 40% chance of killing the fox by the hounds or dogs. And also the ability to control them is really hard. And that's what results in the thing that we're all trying here to stop, which is that we thought we'd stopped, which is encouraging packs of hounds to kill wild animals in the Scottish countryside.
Thank you. Goddard, have you got anything to add?
Thank you. I just revert to the point. I think that the Commission isn't saying that management of foxes shouldn't happen, but just should happen in the best possible way in terms of the welfare of a fox and achieving the objective. So that's the thing that needs to be the priority.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I just want to go back to something that Robbie said. You suggested that between 40% of the time when there's a pack of dogs, the fox gets caught and killed by the dogs. Have you any evidence to compare that with when there's two dogs or three dogs or four dogs rather than a pack?
No. As I say, it was Lord Bonamy's estimate of 20%, and the defence witness at the Jed Forrest hunt who estimated 40%. I've not heard, I'm not aware of anybody. I don't think I'm aware of anybody. But no, you wouldn't flush the guns with just two dogs in Scotland at the moment. That I'm aware of.
Okay, so there's no evidence to compare the difference between...
proving a negative with a negative is always difficult, isn't it? But what I can say is that, as you know, that the League Against Cruel Sports operates in England and Wales as well. And the Westminster legislation reduced the number of dogs to two from the very beginning, and it was a couple of years after the Scottish legislation, and it said that the Westminster legislation learnt from some of the experiences of the Scottish legislation. And since the reduction of dogs to two in England and Wales, I'm not aware of anybody flushing the guns with two dogs in England and Wales. What happened in England and Wales is something which we'll talk about later, is that a whole new sport was invented overnight called trail hunting, which enabled people to go out with full packs of hounds, which is what they wanted to do.
So I'm confused. So there is no evidence currently that the number of foxes that would be killed as a result of using dogs to flush to guns, that the number of foxes is any higher using a pack than it is to just using two dogs, because you're suggesting that
that's because it doesn't
two
happen.
Dogs are not so.
That's because it doesn't happen.
It doesn't happen. Okay, I've got a very short supplementary from Jim Fairley, then Rachel Hamilton.
Robbie, I'd like to come to yourself directly, if that's okay. And I'd like to actually put it on record that I'm glad that everybody in the room accepts that there is a need for land managers to be able to have a method of control in wildlife. And I think that's great that we've got that consensus. And I'd also like to put on record that I would in no way advocate that it is a good idea to allow packs of dogs to go chasing across the countryside and catch a fox and kill it. I'm absolutely opposed to it. So let's be clear about that.
Please.
My question is, Robbie, you talked about, Lord Warner was talking about his 20% of foxes being killed, and that was his estimate. We had Ian Duncan Miller here last week, who is the Highland Perthshire foothound pack. Now, these guys aren't going out hunting. What they're doing is they're trying to control a predator that is damaging to all sorts of wildlife and farm animals. Now, his estimate is that up to 95% of the foxes are driven out and shot. So would it not, the concern that I've always had about this is that if you're driving to standing guns, there's not enough guns. The most important thing is when a fox gets driven, that there's enough guns on the outside. Surely the loophole in the law is that there hasn't been enough care taken about how the fox is dispatched once it has been driven from its cover. Surely that's a far more effective way than trying to put two dogs, because, again, from experience, two dogs in a very wide area necessarily won't flush the fox. They'll go round in circles, because a fox, I have huge respect for, is a very, very clever animal. So the point is to get it out of cover in order to shoot it. So number of guns would be more important than number of dogs, surely.
A point I have made, because, as I said, it seems to me that the practice or the interpretation of the present legislation is that if you have a couple of guns available, then that is a defence to say that even if the pack of hounds do kill the wild animal, that you were flushing to guns. But whether or not that was a realistic attempt to flush the guns, and as I say, in the Jed Forrest case, where the successful prosecution was, there was only one gun, and he gave evidence that he sat and watched the hole that the fox had gone into and had to agree that he could have gone over there and shot the fox at any time and wait for the hunt to come back to release the fox from the cover and then have the dogs chase it. And we have consistently been frustrated by showing the police film that there are no guns around. Now, so I would agree with you that number of guns is important, but I also think that it's easier for enforcement if the police can see whether or not there is a pack of hounds there. If there is a pack of hounds there, then you should be able to go over and say, where's your license? Fine. And I would agree with you, you should also say, where is the effective use of guns? Because, as you know, the range of a shotgun is about 30 metres, and a fox can run in any direction. And so my contention is that you should have somebody with a gun about every 60 metres to shoot each other all around. And then if a fox leaves cover, at the moment, you have a duty to kill it as soon as possible. But what we're seeing is a couple of guns, or no guns, or one gun, or a gun on the horizon, or look at me, I've got a gun, and foxes being chased across the countryside. And that's what I'm hoping this bill will stop.
Thanks very much, but I'm glad that we agree on that point. Thank you.
Brief supplementary, Rachel Hamilton, before moving to Beatrice Wishart.
Yeah, I'm just worried because this is all about animal welfare and it's not about one specific type of predator control. It's about lots of things, and we seem to be focusing on one area. It's about, you know, we heard from Ian Duncan Miller, as Jim said, we heard from a terrier working group. There are various ways of controlling predator to protect livestock, but it is, at the end of the day, about animal welfare. And just going back to Robbie Marsland, Lord Bonamy's review and evidence to this previous committee had made it clear that two dogs would not work, and the use of two dogs to flush to guns has been described as useless by the League of Cruel Sports. So I just wondered if Robbie could comment on that specific point.
Sure. I think I already have. As I say, there has been a scientific paper about the use of two dogs and more than two dogs. And as I said, clearly, if you use more dogs, then foxes will leave cover earlier than if you can only use two dogs. But there is no comment on the scientific paper about animal welfare. And as you rightly say, that's what we're here to talk about. the welfare of the foxes is undermined by the use of more than two dogs, because between 20 and 40% is the evidence that I've heard of foxes would be killed by those dogs rather than being shot. So that's the reason why I think.
I think we need to see some evidence on that, please, Mr. Marsland, because we heard differently from those practitioners last week.
Okay, I can only refer to what Lord Barnaby said, and was quoted in earlier sessions. The evidence from the Jed Forrest trial, I don't think is recorded in a sheriff's court.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. And I guess it's following on from the line of previous questions. When last week we heard from witnesses representing the wildlife management interests on the situations where they believed required more than two dogs. So I'd be keen to hear further your views on the two-dog limit above ground, about the exceptions for management of wild mammals, but including falconry, game shooting, deer stalking, and environmental benefit like ground nesting birds.
Could maybe kick off with Mike?
Yeah. I mean, we support the two-dog limit, but there are exceptions in the bill that a person, whether it's a farmer or for environmental reasons, can apply for a licence if they've got any evidence it's going so. And it comes back to something Mr. Fairley said about dealing with a problem before it arises. And I kind of got the interpretation, listening to last week's session with Mr. Duncan Miller, that he was referring to the fixture list they had. To me, fixture list sounds like football games and rugby can happen, and we know what's going to happen. You can't tell a fox not to cause a problem until the second week in February. So that may be that area, we're going to sweep that area to prevent foxes causing any damage in the future. And that's a different aspect than dealing with a problem that you've actually got. Now, there are exceptions in this. If someone has got a problem and can genuinely say it is going to take more than two dogs, and I heard the example last week, rocky outcrops and certain bits up in the Highlands and stuff, if there is a genuine reason, and Nature Scott, who are the ideal people to carry out that licence, and they're all very countryside-minded and capable of doing their job, then there is a potential that could be granted. So it should have no problem. And again, like Kirsty, I refer back to the RSPB person last week, that they've got interests in both environmental aspects and farming aspects, maybe not as commercial as some people, but they don't use dogs at all on their swathes of land. And I think that kind of speaks volume, because a lot of people, yes, protect livestock, but you've got European directives to protect ground nesting birds and all that kind of stuff. And if they're not using it, and it is the most appropriate. And I think, to refer to other things, Mr. Duncan Miller last week referred to between 90 and 95% are shot. Now, that's back to your point, Mr. Fairley. I think they were saying they've got about 20 guns, but there's still some times where dogs evade the guns, and it's the dogs that kill it. And the whole idea of this, from my point of view, is to ensure as best as possible that dogs do not get used to kill it, because that's not the intention. The intention is you're using an animal, and using hounds. Hounds are there to chase. If it's going back to another aspect on the unintentional consequences, an old lady walking a lass of Apso and the dog gets off a lead, the police are not going to look twice at her. If you're a young guy in combats with two lurchers in a farmer's field that's going to petition, you're going to raise a few eyebrows. It's like in the old theft thing, the person went equipped. Badger bears and all your hairdressers, none of them do it on their own doorstep. They're travelling to places, they're parking a motor up, they've already searched the place, they're going in with dogs that are used for that purpose. Because all dogs are bred for a purpose. Terriers, I get really annoyed when somebody says I've got a Jack Russell Terrier and it went for something. That's what Jack Russells do. They're a terrier. Hounds are for chasing, sight dogs are for chasing and grabbing. You're getting all these mutant things now, the bull lurchers, a cross between a lurcher and a bull terrier. And I would encourage any farmer that sees one on their ground to get one to the police right away, because these people are up to no good. And if we can get to the point, and as I said at the beginning, if everybody had acted in the spirit of the 2002 Act, we wouldn't be sitting here. But it's been abused time and time again. And I know that everybody in the countryside side that was here last week, and they're all, I know most of them, very reputable people, Jake sitting behind me. But they're not all. They're not the people that are getting caught with doing what they do. And I can assure you, dogs also get hurt when it's dealing with foxes. I've seen, and if anybody disagrees with or about foxes anywhere, I can show you plenty of pictures that have actually been in front of court. It's not just us making it up where people have been found guilty. Some of the injuries are horrendous. Now, a good terrier man wouldn't do that, but the ones we're dealing with, they never see a vet. You've got them stapling their cheeks back up at home and all that kind of stuff. So, if anything, and back to your point, Mr. Carson, that putting rabbits in is just to prevent another thing. Anything that can prevent all that kind of stuff has got to be for the good. Sorry.
Thank you. Can I just touch on it again? We're back to this limit on dogs. So we heard last week that between 90 and 95%. Of foxes when you use a pack of dogs on foot are shot. That's a massive difference between 20 and 40%. And the only difference is whether people are on motorbikes or on horses. So it's supposed to be exceptions to the rule. I've not heard one example of where two dogs is the most appropriate number for controlling or flushing. Not one. So it would suggest that every time somebody wants to use dogs at all for flushing, they're going to have to apply for a licence. So that's not an exception. That's the rule. So it would suggest that two dogs is actually an arbitrary limit and there's no scientific basis whatsoever. It's a limit which will prevent packs. So it's more about the League Against Cruel Sports rather than the League Against Cruel Pest Control. And that's where that's an issue that we've heard again and again. This is not about actually more effective, less cruel pest control. It's about just stopping hunting packs, mounted horse packs, whatever. So we need to get back round to what this bill is all about, and it's about animal welfare. So I can't understand why the rule would be two dogs when there's no evidence to suggest in any way that is the best way to flush foxes to guns.
Sorry, convener, in my opinion, the only way you would get that evidence would be looking at what's happening in England and Wales, because they're limited to two. Nobody up here uses two dogs because they're not forced to. This is changing the mindset. I mean,
Mr. Marsland suggested that there wasn't any evidence that anybody was using two dogs to flush the guns.
That's the law down in England, if they're breaking the law down in England.
No, but he said it didn't happen. Unless I misunderstood, Mr. Marsland suggested that there's no evidence that anybody was using two dogs to flush foxes to guns. Maybe he could come and clarify that, unless I misunderstood. Robbie.
May I? I actually have thought of a one instance where two dogs are routinely used in England and Wales, and that is in stag hunting. Again, this is an instance of the lengths that people will go to. Stag hunting used to be done by packs of hounds, where the stag was chased for considerable distances and then finally shot when the stag was exhausted. To enable the people who want to continue to do that, they've been using relays of two dogs. So they put two dogs onto the stag and watch it chase the stag for in some cases, several miles. And then they remove those two dogs and replace them with another two dogs. And that's the way that they've been able to continue what they believe is an entertaining sport. So that's the only example I can remember of the use of two dogs in England and Wales. But it's because it was the mountain hunts found another way of going out with a pack of hounds, which is what they want to do.
But would you also suggest that using two dogs to flush is not an effective way of controlling foxes? Because if it was, that would be...
If you use a full pack, place. Then you're in much more danger of between 20 and 40% of the animals being killed by the pack of hounds, which I think is what this bill is trying to stop from happening. And that's why we support it.
OK, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, convener. And, yeah, so
Mike, you kind of started to talk about this a little bit, but so last week I spoke to Barry Wade from the National Working Terrier Federation, and he stated that the point of a terrier being below ground is not to fight with the fox, but to discourage him from staying below ground. And he also explained to my colleague Mercedes Villalba that in certain circumstances it would be a welfare issue to only send one dog underground because it wouldn't motivate the fox to come up and might stay there too long. But this concern for animal welfare doesn't sit well with other descriptions of terrier work that I have heard. And last week I was talking with a shepherd, and he told me when he was returning from work, he encountered a hunt where he saw a terrier with half of its face torn off after it had been sent down to find the fox. And I'm also aware of the case in Angus last month where a gamekeeper was taken to court after his dogs were found to be seriously disfigured from fighting foxes and badgers, but he claimed the dogs had been injured while carrying out legitimate rattling and foxing duties. Apart from the impact on the dog, I'd like to hear more about the animal welfare implications for foxes and mink, and could I please ask the panel for information on the welfare impacts of terrier work and your views on Exception 5. And I don't know, Mike, maybe you want to pick up because you did start to bring it in.
I mean, obviously I can't do it here, but I'll quite happily send over a briefing paper that will explain the court case. And it's quite common what you've just said there about a terrier with fox and badger injuries, because the people we deal with tend to use them for the same kind of thing. Fox can be a training method for going on to badgers at a later stage. Mr. Barry Wade, I've met him on several occasions, lovely man. I don't know how you can control a terrier underground. Mr. Wade was saying you can't shout because that would stop the fox coming out because it hears a person. But you physically can't do it. And terriers, as I say, terriers do what terriers do. If they're down there, if the fox is lucky enough to just bolt and get out, then it's away from the terrier. If it stays down there, they will face off. Foxes will just bite anywhere they can. They're just defending themselves. So if there's something disturbing it outside, or for whatever reason it doesn't come out and the terrier's there, they will get to that. And that's why Mr. Wade was... That's why you would put a locator collar on it. Because if your dog's down there and you hear it and it's engaging with the fox, the idea is you dig down to it. That can take hours. That is not a quick pastime. You're not just getting one wee shovel and the fox is there. So they do suffer there, and I do have grave concerns about dogs underground, and I see no reason why you would have to put more than one dog down, because these dogs, if you have anybody that's worked with terriers, you get two terriers in a heightened state, they'll bite each other, never mind, it's not just a fox they'll go for. And I'm really pleased to see Mr. Fairley nodding his head there, because that's nothing against terriers, great wee dogs, but that's what they do. So I've got grave concerns about using animals underground, because there is no way you can control them. I've great concerns with a pack of hounds, and if 20 to 40% are killing a fox, where's the control? That's far too many times that the whistle didn't work. Once these animals are on their scent, doing what they've been trained, bred and trained to do, they're going to do it. You can whistle Dixie and they're just going to keep going.
Kirsty.
I would agree. I think Mike's quite succinctly outlined the welfare concerns with sending terriers underground. Any time you have two animals trapped in an enclosed space in a heightened state, I think that's going to, you know, lead to concerns. We would like to see this exception removed.
I'll go to Pete and then Robbie.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I would agree that from a welfare perspective, having these two animals in conflict below ground with absolutely no chance to control the dog is something that would represent a serious welfare concern.
Thank you. And Robbie.
Thank you. I agree with everything else you said. I'd perhaps leave you with this thought. It is entirely illegal and reprehensible, and you get very often would get a prison sentence for encouraging two dogs to fight, illegal dog fighting. So for my mind, I can't see the difference between encouraging two dogs to fight and putting a dog underground where you know there is a fox underground and putting them together. the chances of there being a fight is, I think, clear. And I just don't understand why one of those activities is legal and one is illegal.
Thank you. Just pick up on Mike. One of the issues that Mr. Wade suggested was that there was a one dog limit, and if it was only one dog that was going down, that's where the problems arise, and that the terriers were very well trained to flush and not to fight. But if you had more than one dog underground, it was more likely that the fox would try to find an exit route than stay and fight, because there was more than one dog, there was more noise, more hustle and bustle, and the fox would be more likely to take fright. So in effect, the limiting to one dog would have more animal welfare problems than using two dogs. Is that, but from what you're saying, the whole panel suggests there shouldn't be dogs used underground at all. But if that was to continue, surely the one dog limit is actually making the situation worse, based on the evidence of the expert when it comes to terriers underground.
Yeah, as I say, I get on well with Mr. Wade, but I do disagree with him. I mean, if you've got two dogs there, you're doubling the chance of the dogs engaging face-on-face with the fox. You could get the point that you've got one dog here, another dog there, so it's kind of trapped in between the two of them. I mean, every fox earth's different, and that's when you need the expertise of a greenkeeper or a shepherd that's on the ground, that, whether it's a fox den or a rabbit warren, they can tell the extent of it. So I think you're just by increasing the numbers of terriers down ground, underground, you're increasing the chances of a face-on-face contact. Because a fox will normally do anything it can to evade a dog. So if it's got a dog at the back of it and there's a clear exit there, the fox will take it. I don't believe for one second that a fox has either got the chance to go out or turn and fight the fox when it can go. It will always take its chance to turn and go.
Okay. Thank you. Any further questions, Ariane? Okay. Mercedes.
It was just a supplementary on something you were saying, but it's passed. It's fine.
Okay. Thank you. We'll now move on to look at licensing in sections 4, 8 and 9, and Rachel Hamilton will kick off.
Thank you. And we heard in evidence that licensing will vary by situation. We heard from the Scottish Government, who cited, you know, stoat eradication project in Orkney, and clearly there's measures to increase the number of capercaillie through the control of fox and pine martin and other areas. So Nature Scot are well aware of and able to be the body that issues the licensing. I just wondered if each panel member had an opinion on what so far we've heard in evidence in terms of ensuring that this licensing scheme is as practical and workable as possible. I start maybe with Kirsty.
As I've already outlined, we would like to see any licensing scheme be guided by the ethical principles. I just want to go back to Mr. Fairley's point. I agree that deciding how to gather evidence, what that evidence should be, who should gather it, these are all very difficult questions. Nature Scot has already said, the Scottish Government representative has already said, that Nature Scot will develop any licensing scheme in conjunction with stakeholders. And so that question of the evidence should be fed into by farmers, what is realistic for them to be able to gather, and so on. And so I think that will be an iterative process between Nature Scot and stakeholders who are involved to make sure that the licensing scheme is workable. As you say, we would also like it to incorporate these principles to make sure that it's based on evidence, that animal welfare is prioritised, and that it's a standardised decision-making process throughout.
As you know, I think you're probably following the debate a couple of weeks ago in the Chamber, where we had a debate on the seven principles of ethical wildlife management, and it was an interesting debate, and Mary McCallum, the Minister, said that, you know, we asked specifically if she was signed up to the shared wildlife management approach with other stakeholders, because we've heard during evidence as well that farmers and other stakeholders are part of that conservation principle. And I presume that you would agree that that shared approach is
a good approach, and it does incorporate some of the principles, including, for example, community values, which would take into account ensuring that farmers could protect their livestock.
I definitely agree that having collaboration from a wide range of people who are involved is very important. In terms of the shared approach itself, I've seen the Concordat. It doesn't go into a great level of detail. It's sort of a statement of intent, as far as I can tell. So I couldn't comment in great detail on whether it meets these principles or not. It may be that there's more detail in the working practices that isn't publicly available. So I do not know to what extent it currently meets these ethical principles. I was very encouraged to hear the Minister say that she's working with the Wild Animal Welfare Committee to look at that. I think that's a really positive thing.
Great, thank you. Can I go to Dr. Goddard, please?
Much. Well, certainly, as Kirsty's mentioned...
We can hear you.
Sounds right. Sorry. Certainly, the ethical principles for wildlife control sort of note really that in terms of actually setting the balance for when a licence might be issued would be something I suppose Nature Scotland would need to reflect on in conjunction with others, but also take on board society's expectations overall. We've heard obviously of some individual cases where there is a significant burden on in terms of a farmer, particularly who might be suffering significant losses. But I guess that, you know, that's a wider ethical debate and a societal view that Nature Scotland would need to reflect when it does actually introduce the licensing scheme. And we would be very keen to, from the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission perspective, be happy to be involved with that. But equally, as the Minister has indicated, we're happy to be involved with the discussions with Nature Scots in, if you like, I suppose in a way, modernising a view about wildlife welfare in general, and we're happy to play a part in that.
Would you agree, Dr. Goddard, that the ability for a farmer to control predators to protect livestock and therefore animal welfare is part of an ethical principle?
Yes, we would say that, and we're not saying that wildlife management shouldn't happen against that backdrop. We're just saying the conditions for that to happen are something that require, if you like, an overarching ethical scrutiny.
Okay, and before I bring in Mr. Marsland, expanding the question to Mr. Marsland, if I could, on the fact that the license is almost broken into two parts, where it's sort of predator control and environmental benefit. So, you know, ensuring that we increase biodiversity, species numbers in terms of the wading birds. We've heard loads of evidence with regards to, you know, how the RSPB, for example, practice, they control predators, hundreds of foxes per annum, and able to do that. What are your views on the licensing and how that could be practical and workable?
I agree that any licensing scheme needs to be practical and workable. And I have to say, I thought that the officials in, I think it was the first session, did a very good job in explaining how that could proceed. I also, as you know, feel that it's an opportunity for a licensing scheme for us to make sure that, as the RSPB do, and as it was explained by Duncan or Ewing, that they understand the nature of the problem that is trying to be solved by killing an animal, that you've worked out how it will be improved by killing that animal and how you're going to continue to monitor it. And I felt that when the officials outlined that process, I could see that happening, and that it didn't need necessarily have to happen in a way that would stop necessary control of wildlife. And I guess it's that necessary bit that I think is the most important one, because it does seem to me that if you make a decision to kill an animal, then we should know why we're doing it, and we should know that it will actually solve the problem that we think it will do. And if a licensing scheme could help us do that, then that would be a really good thing.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things there, I think I said earlier on, if Nature Scotland are going to be able to apply these licences properly, they need proper guidance, in whether it's actually in the bill or in the guidance notes, on what is an exception and what can apply. So as long as they've got the ground rules, I'm pretty sure that they will be able to cope with the extra demands. But one of the things, if you're looking at the ethical bit, you'll see, right, that's the control you did last year, and we want to do it again next year. Well, it didn't work last year. And again, I'm just thinking back to last week's session, that the footpack that was being described over a five-month period, I think they mentioned 153, 154 foxes in a very large area, which if you, the latest estimate I can see for fox population in Scotland is around 23,000 every year. It's pretty stable. Goes massively up in the summer, then natural mortality and all that kind of stuff. So in a huge area like that, footpacks taken, I wouldn't have thought 154 foxes in prime land was going to make any great difference. And I'm not saying they should have gone hell for leather and killed more, but it just that's something that in time, like the two-dog limit, has it been more successful, which should take account of licences in the future on the ethical principles. So you're doing it, but it's not making any difference.
Last week was that possibly reapplying time after again, particularly during a vulnerable season, say just lambing, but it's not that, it's over a longer period. So a licence that could be valid up to 2 years, for example, for preservation, protection or restoration, particularly to increase biodiversity species on land, which is effectively happening as a positive consequence and benefit on land. You mentioned, Mike, there about earlier about topography and the difficulties within controlling predators within woodland or whatever it might be. I think, do you think from your experience of working with farmers that it's actually going to be quite bureaucratic and not very time efficient for them to be continually applying for licences? Do you think there should be an option to have a general licence rather than a sort of 14-day?
Yeah, but well, no farm likes extra paperwork or extra bureaucracy. But this would only apply if they were what you use more than two dogs, so they can still do their predator control at the moment, whether they're using snaring, which I have to admit I do not agree with. I think that's another practice that needs to be looked at. But shooting, the majority of farmers that I know personally shoot when they've got a problem at the time. Okay, that doesn't take account of Mr. Fairley's problem that, well, let's prevent it before it happens. But that's a different debate. So I don't really have a great concern with the licensing aspect. What I do have a concern with is the category of person. There's a thing that could be to an individual or a category of person. What is the category of person? Is it any gamekeeper on that estate? Is it any of this? The idea of a licence is the police doing independent monitors or whatever. I've got a problem. You're the licence holder. You're responsible. You kind of go a category of person. Who's in charge of that category of person? You've got to have a person that's responsible. So if it's category people, you've got one name that if something goes wrong and they're not there on the day to ensure that it complies with the licence, they should be held accountable.
Thank you. Sadly, we're now coming to the time of the meeting where I've got to ask people to have very short supplementaries and I direct them to a specific witness. So can I bring in Mercedes Villalba and then Emma Harper?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panellists. The bill as proposed allows for a licence to use more than two dogs to be obtained under specific circumstances. And Rachel Hamilton has reminded us that the committee heard evidence last week from Ian Duncan Miller in opposition to 14-day licences due to the administrative burden this would cause, as licences would be required to cover the full shooting season. So multiple licences would be applied for sequentially. So with this in mind, can I ask if the panel have any concerns that what is intended to be an exceptional licensing arrangement within the bill will actually be sought as the default and will effectively create a loophole for hunting with more than two dogs to continue? I'd like to hear from as many panellists as possible, maybe beginning with Kirsty and also Robbie, if we have time.
Yeah, there does seem to be a sort of a discrepancy in how different people are seeing this licensing. The Scottish Government officials described it as an exception to an exception that would be a serious step, so not something that would be given out routinely. And the panel last week seemed to be very much saying that it needed to be given out continuously year-round. I think we would agree that it should be an exception to an exception. As Mike's already said, it's not stopping people using other methods to control foxes if necessary. It's not stopping people using two dogs. All it's saying is that you need a licence for the use of more than two dogs. I've already outlined our views that other methods should, first of all, mitigation measures should be tried. If you do need to resort to lethal control, other methods are preferable. So we would not want to see the licensing sort of relaxed or changed in any way.
Robbie Marsden, briefly, please.
Thank you. I'm just going to quote from what Police Scotland said to Lord Bonamy. They said that exceptions to the offence to deliberately hunt a wild animal with a dog are multiple and provide opportunities for exploitation by those who continually and deliberately offend. That's the context we're operating in. I just wanted to remind people of that.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning. My question is, I'll just direct it to Mike, actually. I'm assuming that when a licence is applied for, it is to ensure responsible predator control, and obviously there needs to be flexibility because we've heard about capercaillie management, we need fox management, whether it's a lambing season. So I guess my question is, if a licensing should be flexible, it should determine on what control is being sought, and so that we can help look at basically responsibly managing the predators that are out there.
I totally agree, and that's why I was saying earlier on that Nature Scotland have got to have clear guidance, and that should include turnaround times. So if a farmer has got severe problems going on, it doesn't take 3 weeks to get the licence, because by then you're far too late. And then you've also got to look at, and this is what Nature Scotland hopefully will look at, the intention of using the dogs more than two. Is it for that is an animal that is eventually going to be killed? So that to me is the hunting aspect, as opposed to the hedgehogs and the youths. The intention there is just to locate the dog so that they can be trapped and moved away. So there's two different threads here, but I would like to think if they've got the proper guidance, they could turn around any potential licence with evidence, whatever that is. Well, here's why I need more than two dogs. And the rocky outcrops I mentioned earlier on, or a huge forest plantation. I would like to think a face-to-face discussion going, well, do you honestly think two dogs could get anything out of that massive forest or cover that rocky outcrop? And you've got to remember that Nature Scotland have got a background and they're doing all the licensing at the moment anyway. And they're used to all these different scenarios being thrown at them. But they need clear definitions of what is the exception to the exception and what should and should not apply.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, convener. I'm going to direct this question to Robbie Marsland first, and if there's time, possibly Kirsty. So, Robbie, the evidence from the League Against Cruel Sports states that your organisation's belief that the proposed licensing scheme will simply create a new loophole, which will still allow for traditional fox hunting to take place. Could you please explain that point? Why would being allowed to use more than two dogs allow traditional fox hunts to continue, while a hard limit of two dogs maximum would effectively end the practice?
Thank you for that. Well, as I said at the beginning, any opportunity to use a full pack of hounds out in the middle of the countryside where the police rightly don't have the resources to follow hunts in the way that my field investigators are, gives the opportunity, as I said before, for exceptions to offence to kill a fox in this way, provide opportunities for those people who want to do that to continue to do it. And that's the main concern I have about the exceptions. If the exceptions are rigorously enforced, and that you have to, that the only way you can use a full pack of hounds is because that's the only way to control a recognised problem, then we would have no problem with that. My fear is that those people who are determined to use packs of hounds to chase and kill foxes will find ways to get those licences. If they don't, then I would be content.
Thank you. And Kirsty?
Yeah, I don't have a huge amount to add, except that, I mean, experience from the 2002 Act shows that if there are potential loopholes, they may be exploited. And so I think any of these exceptions could potentially create a loophole. And that's just why we're encouraging that they're scrutinised quite closely for that reason. And also just to see, are they really necessary?
I think on that point, again, it's back to clear definitions. I mean, rabbits and mice are excluded. And we've suggested in our written evidence that if somebody is, they should define the place it's being used. You can't just say, I've got my dogs out because there's a rat up in that bit. Rats are specific to certain places, food stores. I've seen them in livery yards and all that kind of stuff. So I wouldn't, if there's anything in this bill that could be a loophole, the people that want to abuse it will find the loophole. And I can just say, I wasn't after a fox, I was after a rat because my dog's in it. You're not going to be chasing or trying to control rats in an open area. You're controlling them for a purpose in a grain silo or something like that. So again, it's the definitions and making sure that everybody is well aware of them to avoid the loopholes. Because nobody wants to be back here in 10 years' time saying this has failed. And as I said at the very beginning, if people take the intention of this once it's tightened up properly, hopefully, like everybody else hopes, we don't have to address this again. And it is only genuine pest control that's happening, or for genuine environmental reasons.
Rachel Hamilton.
Just to follow up on Mr. Marsden's point about Police Scotland not having enough resources. Do you think that's an issue that should be addressed with the government? And what is a field investigator?
What I think I recognise is that police resources are hard pressed, and I don't think that I would be suggesting that the police should be doing what the League's field investigators do, which is spend time filming the activities of those people who say they're flushing to guns. And it's the video evidence that we gathered over the last 5 years that I think convinced Lord Bonamy that there was still traditional hunting going on, even though we thought we had banned it over 20 years ago, and therefore the need for this legislation to make sure that we do really ban fox hunting in Scotland.
Do your field investigators, what do they do? Do they follow all types of predation control in Scotland, including footbacks?
No, I was asked to look at the activities of mounted hunts in Scotland.
So there's a gap. There's a gap, really, where police. We need to probably get Police Scotland here as a witness to ensure that they are doing their job, because you're insinuating that really they're not because of resources.
We do have Police.
Great. Thank you.
I don't think they're not doing their job. I think there have been a successful prosecution and two or three cases where the police have taken suspected hunters to court. So it does happen, but I have to say that they are, I think would be the right word to use, dependent on the film that we have been able to supply them.
Thank you. We're now going to, in the last few minutes, prohibition on trail hunting. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. And I'll address it to Mike first. I'd like your view on the prohibition of trail hunting and also your views on the exception to the trail hunting ban to allow the training of dogs to follow an animal-scented, an animal-based scent.
Yeah, I mean, from my knowledge, training trail hunting only came in down south when the hunt legislation came in, so it was a way of continuing to perform the pastime that they wanted. And it can easily be used if you're training or getting animals to follow an animal scent. Fox urine and it's gone that way, and another fox scent goes that way. The dogs are equally as likely to engage in a hunt. The exceptions are obviously sensible for environmental purposes, to train a dog to find hedgehogs in the US that's got to know the smell and be trained to go to the smell of a hedgehog and all that kind of stuff. So for certain exceptions, it's correct. And sorry, convener, can I go back about 20 minutes because I forgot your last question, Deputy Convener, about the exceptions for falconry, game shooting and sport. The Scottish SPCA supports this bill and we totally accept necessary pest control and environmental protection. We don't accept, as you say, dogs for any kind of pastime or sport. And to me, falconry is a pastime. Nobody goes out hawking now to put food on the family table. It is a pastime that goes on. If it's simply to shoot as a sport, then we don't think there should be any exceptions because it's not essential like pest control, environmental protection is.
Thank you. Can I maybe bring Dr. Goddard in briefly and then Robbie Marsden on the trail hunting, please? Sorry, Dr. Goddard, we're not hearing you at the moment.
Sorry. I would agree with the contention made already about trail hunting, and that is that there could be unintended consequences, and as a result, we would not be supportive of that continuing. Drag hunting, of course, is a different thing, often confused in people's mind, but there is virtually no chance of unintended consequences in that circumstance.
Thank you. And Robbie, and then Kirsty.
Yeah, I would agree. I think the only change that I would suggest is that this over the last 7 years has been very, very little drag hunting in Scotland. But the last two seasons, I think, the Fife Hunt have become the Kingdom Blazers on Saturdays. And they've been following a human scent. So a runner goes up the front. So I would just say that to make sure that that can continue, probably the best thing to do is to limit the use of a human scent as opposed to a non-animal scent. That way there would be no danger of somebody saying they were following an aniseed scent and then they were actually chasing foxes. So that's a detailed suggestion I would make.
Okay, thank you. And Kirsty.
Thank you. I agree with the others. The Scottish Government is wise to preemptively ban trail hunting, considering what's happened down south, and we're not opposed to the exception because it's necessary. I actually just wanted to pick up on Mike's other point as well. We would agree with him that there's no justification for an exception for sport. I would also question the inclusion of a bird of prey as a method of killing throughout the bill. That doesn't really make sense to me. It's not a necessary humane method. I know the Scottish Government said that they had no wish to ban falconry, but that still doesn't explain its inclusion as a method of killing in the other exceptions. I also just wanted to comment, there seems to be a little bit of a discrepancy. The situation where a wounded deer needs to be tracked by dogs has been brought up a couple of times. That's actually something that we can see the necessity for if deer are being shot for necessary management purposes and one is wounded. There is a reason that they would need to be tracked by a dog for their own welfare. That actually doesn't, in the wording of the bill, that doesn't seem to be covered. The bill talks about flushing to guns or locating an animal that's been killed, but it doesn't actually mention an animal that's been wounded. So I just wanted to mention that maybe should be looked at.
Thank you. That's very useful. And finally, we're going to move on to part three of the bill, looking at enforcement. Alistair Allan.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just very briefly, Dr. Goddard We've had written evidence from yourselves about the issue of disqualification and deprivation orders, I think. And it was just really to ask your view about how you feel the bill deals with that, again, whether you feel it deals with it adequately. For instance, there's something in there about preventing the persons concerned from owning the horse concerned. I just wonder if you feel that plugs a loophole in the law.
Well, I think we were overall happy with the provisions. This was just a case of being absolutely clear in terms of what the penalties were. So that was the point we were making there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Panel members like to come in, Mike?
There's one other thing I'd like to say, but not on that point.
Certainly. Okay, we're coming to the end of the session, but Mike, if you'd like to make another contribution, please feel free.
Yeah, it's just that the previous legislation, or the one that this is going to replace, actually had a bit in about that the person's to ensure that the animal's not, that an animal being used is not injured, and that's missing in this one. So we would like to see something in the legislation that an animal being used in the course of this, if it's injured, must one, be rescued if it's a terrier trapped underground, or receive the appropriate veterinary treatment if it's injured in the course of a lawful activity.
And we've got a final brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I've raised it in all the other sessions, and it was just really to Kirsty, because you mentioned about mental health and farmers, and it was whether you thought that a provision for compensation should be part of this bill in case there was animal loss due to perhaps something that was deficient within the licensing scheme or whatever it might be. I'm not sure I can comment on the specifics of that. I think it's something that would be worth considering. I don't know if it's realistic. I don't know that I'm best placed to determine that. I do think, as I said at the beginning, that the mental health of farmers is a concern. They're under a lot of pressure just now. I think that, as I've already said as well, that there are changes needed in wildlife management, but the onus of that shouldn't fall on farmers. It shouldn't increase the pressure on them, and if compensation was one way to ensure that then it should be considered, but I don't know that I'm best placed to say whether that's how that would work.
Can I just add on that point, if we get that kind of concern raised by a farmer, we work in conjunction with RSABI, who are a fantastic charity that do support farmers and crofters in so many different ways, and they would be able to help out in that aspect as well.
I notice Robbie would like to come in, but could you possibly touch on the compensation question as well, if there's any indication that as a result of this bill coming in, it might be to the detriment of certain groups who there'd be compensation. Could you touch on that as well, Robbie, when you make your contribution?
The compensation issue came up, I think, last week for the first time, and it's not something I've really given much thought to in the past. So I don't really feel able to comment just now.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of this session. I would like to thank you all for attending, either in person or remotely. Your evidence has been very useful, and we now suspend this meeting until 11:15 to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Okay, I'd like to welcome everybody back. Now, welcome to the meeting the Right Honourable Lord Bonamy, who in 2016, his report made recommendations to improve the operation of the Protection of Wild Mammals Scotland Act 2002. With your permission, we're just going to go straight into questions. So can I ask you what your overall assessment of the situation around hunting with dogs in Scotland is following your review in 2002?
Well, good morning, convener and members of the committee. At that time, my assessment was that it was one of great uncertainty. As you know, I found it difficult to make findings about the factual position. My big idea at the time is one you obviously didn't take up, which was the idea of monitoring what was going on monitoring on the basis of a protocol that all the interested parties would subscribe to, seeing how that went, because I thought that in itself was a control mechanism, and then looking at what the facts actually showed you. I had in mind that there were so many ex-police officers that used to ride horses that there was a cartel of individuals readily available for the role. However, what I can't make any comment about is how the situation may have changed since. I've seen rough figures that suggest perhaps more foxes have been killed. Even when I was doing it, there were a number every year apparently illegally killed. But it was specific information was difficult to find.
The code of conduct, there was a sort of unwritten code of conduct. Did you think that resulted in any improvements in the situation with regards to what was illegal hunting?
Well, I thought the code of conduct was a genuine effort to control what was happening. I mean, no doubt there are rogues in hunting like most aspects of life, but there are so many genuine individuals involved who were determined that they would preserve their sport and the social aspects that went with it. And I thought there was a prospect that that would work. Now, it wasn't written in legal language. It could have been improved, and I made proposals that should be done. There was an argument at that stage, and there was definitely evidence that the hunting fraternity were keen to maintain their sport and to comply with the law.
So what's your initial impressions of the draft bill that we have in front of us in relation to your review?
Well, before dealing with that, can I say I regard this as a very well-crafted piece of legislation. It solves the problems I identified about the loose use of language, the variable use of language, and it makes everything much clearer and simpler. And that in itself should be a great, great incentive to better enforcement of the law, because the police and fiscal service were struggling with the effective detection and then prosecution of offenders. So, and you've done something I wish was done far more often, and that is you've repealed the whole of the previous legislation and put something new in place. I mean, the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act is still the 1995 Act as amended, and the difficulties you have actually finding things are extraordinary. So it's good from that point of view. Beyond that, though, I don't think there's anything I particularly commented on that you've done. You haven't ordered dogs to be muzzled. I seem to have got that one right. I was disappointed in the failure to do anything about the idea of getting everybody together and working together. I can see other reasons for not imposing various vicarious liability on landowners. A bit disappointed in not going for the reversing the onus of proof. I know that's a difficult and controversial area, but this is an activity that's conducted in a way that's very difficult to observe. And you know the lens that the League of Against Cruel Sports go to provide the evidence. And but for them, we wouldn't have much on film that you could go on. So I thought there was a strong case for that. But in Scotland, we are very averse to the notion of reversing the onus. And we're also, of course, averse to the notion of vicarious liability. Football, for example, is a good example of that, where there might be a solution to many of the problems, but nobody's prepared to look in that direction. So I understand the reluctance to accept. But I hope you've also viewed that report as something that tried to think out the box a bit to provide solutions for a very difficult problem.
Thank you. We're now going to look more specifically at the bill. Mercedes Villalba.
Apologies, convener.
Would you like me to move on to the next question? I'll tell you what, I'll bring in Rachel Hamilton at the moment.
Morning, Lord Bonamy. It's really around the revised language. You've already touched on that slightly in terms of sections 1 and 2 of the bill, which are around the offences and exceptions. For example, I jog your memory, which I probably don't have to really, but it's about the word deliberately and then again the definition of a wild mammal. I wondered what you... To give your views on that, but also do you think that the way that this, you said it's, you feel it's been improved, but do you, based on the evidence of your original review, will the bill in its current form allow effective and humane control of predators? So it's three points there.
Well, the word deliberately was causing a problem, and removing it was a good idea. There were various ways of describing the point at which the shooting should take place as soon as possible, reasonably possible, when it's safe to do so. It's a vast improvement to just have everywhere as soon as reasonably possible. I would take out reasonably, but I've no quibble with the fact that it's there. It's an easy one for a court to deal with in any event. You might find there's good reason for it. I don't know. I think any degree of clarity is going to improve the enforcement of legislation. The problem here is finding the evidence in the first place. And the evidence, as I say, I've already said, it's difficult to do that. On the definition of wild mammal, the only comment I had thought of was it makes sense to protect the rabbit for the reason that's given. That makes, to me, common sense. So all along, when I was looking at the changes, they seemed to me to be advancing the cause of both protection of the right mammals and allowing for effective enforcement.
And on the basis, thank you for that, and on the basis of your original review, and it's a really difficult thing to articulate here, but obviously, the main issue that we're looking at is to have some sort of workable, practical way of controlling predators to protect livestock, but also ensure that there's the highest possible animal welfare. For the fox, with the way that the changes have been made, do you see any problems that there could be in terms of the animal welfare of the fox?
I suspect the fox will now have a better chance of survival because even the flushing out will be much more difficult with two dogs than with a properly organised pack. And when you get into upland areas and scrub, the foot packs will find it very difficult to do their job, I think, with only two dogs. Now, I understand that in England, that is the system. What I don't know about what you probably know is whether it's felt that it works. Are the Welsh upland farmers or hill farmers, are they content that they are only allowed to use two dogs? Do they have a licensing system? I don't know that either. If it hasn't been done, there must be evidence available from how things have worked in England to tell you whether it is effective with only two dogs.
I think we'll be covering the two-dog question shortly. Were there any other changes within Section 1 or 2 that you had noticed that perhaps would improve the bill itself?
Well, if I can go back just to complete, there is another point. I think there's an argument for there being some sort of conditions attached. Well, I don't know how you do this, but if you're licensing, if you're applying a license to the number of guns that there should be, if people are out with two dogs and two guns, there's loads of space for escape. It's going to be very difficult, I think, in that situation to catch the fox. And we all know that the fox itself is a pretty active beast, not only in the countryside, but an urban. It's becoming an urban teddy boy, really. I'm not in a position to. I was happy that it was better to use a pack, and I better not go into that just now. You can ask me about that later.
I think
later
we've been on. Given the that we've been given a site of your original review, which had an issue with the animal welfare. With less than two dogs.
But on section 1 and 2, I think these adequately cover the problem. And I can't see any reason for adding anything offhand, and you certainly should avoid unduly complicating it. Even the way it's set out throughout the Act, although it's about twice the length of the other one, it's far clearer, and things are divided up in a way that's much easier to the mind to read. For someone who doesn't know the activity particularly well, it's much easier to interpret, read and interpret.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
I'm going to jump out of order that the members think we're going to ask the questions in, because I think we are right now somewhat focusing on two dogs. And we have a question from Ariane Burgess on that. Do you maybe want to bring your question in now and we can follow that trail of questioning?
Thanks, Convener. And good morning, Lord Bonamy. It's good to meet you. In the evidence session for the Eclair Committee in 2017, you stated that in general, 20% or more of foxes disturbed by hounds are actually killed by hounds in the course of flushing. And you expressed your opinion that reducing the number of dogs allowed to two would bring the practice of flushing to guns to an end. You went on to state, and I quote, "The change would, I think, mean the end of hunting as we see it at the moment." Could you please explain why you believe this to be true?
Well, the activity had already changed its form. Hunting with a chase and a catch was a sport that was widely practiced. The sport tried to adapt, and the way it found of adapting, as I saw it, was to become a pest control agency. With the dogs that they had, they advised me that they were pretty effective in that activity, and they were invited by landowners widely to carry it out for them at appropriate times. But the pack of hounds was the thing that these sportsmen and women loved to be associated with. That's what they wanted to be enjoying, controlling these hounds in open space. And I just formed the impression that it had already, the number of packs hadn't changed very much, but I got the impression there was a lack of enthusiasm for the change that had taken place, and I felt in the end that two hounds might be a step too far for the body. But that's something that they will now have had to face up to and would have to answer, I think. What's going to happen to them in the situation where this legislation, if it looks likely to succeed?
Sorry, can I just clarify? Two hounds would be a step too far for the body. What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean that they enjoyed the sport of riding out with hounds, controlling the hounds, directing them. They had a way of using them which was pest control. In their view, it was working well. I imagine that, and this was what they expressed, but of course they're bound to at that stage because they're arguing their cause, but what they were expressing to me was that they saw the whole social and sporting aspect of this being gradually effectively reduced by the legislative change that had already been made, and they saw themselves as fighting a rearguard action at that point.
Thank you.
Chris Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Lord Bonamy. I was just on the two-dog limit, the introduction of it, I just wondered what your views were and your opinions on the proposed licensing scheme as well.
Oh, I mean, the licensing scheme is what I think makes it viable to have two dogs. That there must be circumstances that people can justify where more dogs are appropriate, and licensing allows for that in a way that maybe is the saviour for the hunting fraternity. I don't know, but I didn't get the impression that this would be something that would be readily granted in an area where these hunts are active. If I'm wrong about that, it may be different. I think the idea of keeping the licence restricted is also a good one. Whether that will evolve from experience, I don't know, but I've observed some comments being made that 14 days is not long enough for the activities that the licence might relate to, and in these circumstances then obviously there must be changes. I don't know anything about the way things work on that front, but I think the idea of limiting licences and not giving somebody, because he's applied a licence like a liquor licence, so he can do what he pleases in that, I don't think that's an answer. I think it has to be restricted in some way, time-wise.
Thank you.
Just to follow on from that, you know, it's the license. You have a license, which is supposed to be the exception, if you like. Do you think there's a danger that the decision the number of dogs is arbitrary? So, as you said, that the two dogs, there's an argument that's just been brought in to stop mounted packs. That's it. We want to stop the groups who go out and hunt for pleasure. And the way to do that is reduce the number by two. And that would appear to what has happened south of the border. So we've heard today that there's very, very few, if any, occasions where two dogs are used to flush foxes to guns. And in your review, you noted that Lord Burns' observation regarding the death of foxes The crux of it, the precise cause of death was less important than the speed at which the death occurred, because the death by dogs is a matter of seconds. So it's more about the pursuit, which is the main source of welfare concerns. Not nailer research showed that using two dogs rather than a pack can actually result in an increased period of pursuit. So would it not seem logical that in most cases, and I'm still to find anybody who can tell me where two dogs would be the most appropriate and the most animal welfare-minded way to flush foxes, why would it be an arbitrary two dogs when there's no evidence to suggest that anywhere that would be the most appropriate number of dogs?
Well, I think my impression is that what the public would find most distasteful is the dog actually killing the fox. And there's an ignorance about how effectively the dog can kill the fox. A lot of the debate previously did focus on the length of the chase that can result. I suppose two dogs would reduce the process. I don't know if they have a pace dog and then he drops off, and but it depends how it's done. The body that, you know, going back to my experience at the time, there was a distinct difference in approach between the mounted hunts and the foot packs. And it was much easier to accept what the footpacks told you was going on, probably because there wasn't an argument against them, because I don't think the League of Cruel Sports bothered with what they were doing. So they were very anxious to make the point that the most important factor is actually the number of guns that you take. And foot packs traditionally always used guns, whereas guns only became commonplace in mounted packs following the legislation in 2002. Another reason, I think, why it was seen as yet another challenge to the way in which they conducted their activity, that they had to take guns with them, which they didn't particularly want to do, but I mean, that's one that's beyond prayer now. That's an obvious necessity.
Cedric Villalba's got a supplementary, but I'm going to bring in Jim Fairley first because he's got a particular view on the guns being part of the legislation. Jim.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Lord Bonamy. Thank you very much for coming along. I have to say, I really did like your description, without being denigrating, to Teddy Boys, the urban foxes being the new Teddy Boys. I think that was brilliant. I'm trying to piece together all the stuff that you've been talking about, but I've asked the question from day one: is the problem with this legislation not the number of dogs but the number of guns? Because one of the things you said at the start of your evidence here just now was that how can hunters maintain their sport while allowing the fox to be chased and stay within the law? Now, I can't understand how they can, because the sport, from my point of view, from what I can see, is that the fox gets flushed and then it gets chased so that riders can ride after it. That, to me, is the sport. Pest control is the fox gets flushed and is shot immediately on sight by whatever. And where the loophole in the law is, that I can see, is that you've got a 200-metre distance of a wood or whatever it is that's being flushed. One gun at one end and one gun at the other, and the fox goes straight through the middle and then everybody else comes in behind it. Surely the law should be looking at the effective and immediate death of the fox on flushing rather than the number of dogs that are chasing it.
Yes, that's what the Act says. But it's not necessarily how it's going to work. I take your point. I mean, if you take, as soon as reasonably possible, as soon as the flush has been flushed, it's to be killed as soon as reasonably possible. And if once you've got to the end of the flushing exercise, it should be killed. But
how can hunters maintain their sport while staying within the law?
Well, they can't maintain that part unless the law simply recognises that as long as you're trying to kill it, you're doing your best. So if you've got two guns in the way you describe, yeah, then the argument will be that I did my best.
Yeah. So what we have this morning across all the groups is an acceptance that land managers, farmers, conservationists have a necessity to have a certain amount of wildlife control or predator control, and we all accept that. So if we're going to use dogs the most effective way, as all the evidence has shown us, is an appropriate number of dogs as a full pack. So walked up, mounted, unmounted packs is a very effective way of getting foxes out of woodland, dense cover and all the rest of it. So the number of guns, to me, seems to be the most important bit, as opposed to the number of dogs.
Well, I think the number of guns is vital, and I think that, as I've said, the different way that the footpacks went about it didn't seem to me to involve a chase.
Now, it was just a flush to get shot.
Yeah, but flushing in certain areas, I mean, the hunts I've observed found, I mean, the pack of dogs could find it difficult to flush the fox out. The huntsman might be with them quite some time while they're flushing, and they're enjoying a form of sport in doing that.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, that might be a different form of riding from the gallop that they get onto after that, but you could see the manoeuvring and controlling of the dogs going on in a difficult flush.
Right, okay. One very quick thing in terms of the licensing. We had various conversations this morning about the necessity. I don't think there's any dispute. We've all agreed that foxes in particular can be a pest to lambs and various other things. In terms of the licence, I know that you're saying is that the exception to the exception, but is there not an argument here for that there should be a seasonal ability to be able to know where you're going to go and control fox numbers, rather than saying, I have a particular problem right now and I need a licence to deal with it? Is there not an argument for a seasonal control rather than a one-off issue?
I think there must be, assuming the evidence shows that for a certain part of the year, this is a nuisance that needs to be addressed. But that doesn't change the principle that there should be some limitation on an exception of that nature.
So the determination of whether or not there is a nuisance, if we accept the fact that a fox will predate lambs and it will predate chicks during a particular season, would it not be more advantageous to deal with it prior to it becoming a problem rather than in the event of it becoming a problem?
I can see that argument. It's okay. Not for me to decide in the end.
Okay, thank you very much.
Rachel Hamilton, then Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. Just to go back to the review itself, because that's the interesting part here. One point, when I'm listening to you, did you observe foot packs and quad bike packs?
I didn't observe foot packs. I did see a hunt with quad bikes being used, yes.
Okay.
I mean, it looks ridiculous, but that's a personal view. It didn't, but that, you've got to remember how far back my life goes. So I see it as a social thing, and it just looked very odd. But if it's effective and more effective, you know, that's where the gun. That's where I mean the a man on horseback isn't normally going to be carrying a gun to shoot the fox, so the quad bike is the vehicle that the individual is using to get to the point where he should be, as soon as reasonably possible, killing the fox.
I ask.
And I saw that happen.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt you, but I ask because that we're hearing evidence from all sorts of people who are going to be affected by the bill, and some of the possible unintended consequences that will arise from the bill, which we heard last week. And it might be useful to look at that evidence if you have time, because it was quite interesting. But the one area that I want to press you on is the when in the review that you said that if flushing with you have less than two dogs, that it could seriously compromise effective pest control in the countryside. How do you think that observation that you made within the 2002 review could have bearing or weight to the argument with regards to the two dog limit on this particular bill?
Well, I can't answer that because I don't know what the evidence is of what's been going on since 2016. So I just don't know.
Maybe ask it in a different way. What made you come to that conclusion in 2002?
I just thought that the flushing of the Fox would be more difficult for a start, and I then doubted whether the hunting sport would continue as it was, so it as a pest control agency might end. But no doubt someone else would appear on the scene in a, with an even, well, with a more distasteful form of execution. I mean, it may be a rapid form of extermination that, in itself, but whether it becomes, you know, publicly distasteful, and it depends what it is. But I can see the thing, I can see the method of pest control moving away from the use of hunted packs. I don't think it would move away from the use of foot packs if the exceptions, the licensing provisions allowed for them to carry out their pest control with a larger number of dogs over a material period of the year.
I think it is quite good for the committee to understand what the difference is between various methods of control with dogs. In terms of, are you saying from a scientific or evidence-based point stance that you still agree with what you concluded in terms of the compromising effective pest control, taking into account that this is done, and Ian Duncan Miller from the Footpack, you know, he was discussing, I think, I can't remember how many dogs he said he used, but it was maybe 30.
Yeah, I mean, that's right. But the point is, these, they are on foot. They're not jumping onto a quad bike after they get the fox flushed. And they can't shoot it unless it's right there in front of them when it's flushed. So it's difficult to see that breaches the previous legislation or will breach this legislation, except in respect of the number of dogs. And it seems to me they're going to have a problem with two dogs, because it's going to be much more difficult for them to nail the fox in the first place before they shoot it.
One last point.
No, sorry.
Oh, no, on you go.
We're going to have to move on. Sorry about that. Mercedes Villalba.
Very much. Thank you. Hi, good morning. It was a supplementary related to the question from Jim Fairley about an approach to fox management which would involve preemptively killing foxes based on a belief or understanding that foxes in general have been known to harm livestock. And that's one approach. And then there's another approach which would be based on looking at specific instances where livestock have been harmed, gathering evidence about the cause of that, and if it was found to be a fox, locating that fox and killing it. And of those two approaches, I wondered if you would share a view on which you think to be the more ethical approach.
No, I think I don't think it is for me to say. I think that's a matter for the licensing authority that's eventually entrusted with this particular task. And they will be the ones to judge whether a preemptive strike is a legitimate way of going about it. I don't have the knowledge and background in farming or in pest control to say, you know, how that, which or whether both of them fit neatly into what's acceptable practice or not.
You wouldn't like to give a view on the ethics of it? Of either approach?
Well, when I hear that, I don't know that it is really an ethical matter. When I hear that substantial numbers of lambs are killed on farms by predators such as the fox, and it's known every year that that's going to happen, I can see the argument for a preemptive strike. But equally, I can understand the argument that in a given instance where someone turns to sheep farming for the first time and there's no evidence that that particular flock has been affected in the past, it might not be an appropriate way to go. So I think it's for the licensing authority, on the basis of all the facts that they are presented with, to make that decision.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, convener. So last week I was having a conversation with a shepherd who works in the borders, and he said that, yeah, he does lose lambs. And I asked him, so what do you do when you start to lose lambs? He said he monitors the fields where that's happening. And then the method that he uses is if predation is frequent. And also what he noted is it tends to be a lamb of, the fox tends to take the lamb from twins. But what he said is that for him, fox mounted hunts is not an effective form of fox control. And what they, and I said, what do you do? And he said, they bring in a marksman who does lamping, who sits out on the land, sits out overnight, and that tackles the situation. He also told me that he knows people that participate on quad bikes in, and it was illuminating to me, actually, what you talked about at the beginning, that there was this shift from mounted hunts being a sport to a form of pest control, I think that. So that the shepherd was saying that in talking to people who do the mounted hunts on quad bikes or mount on horses, that it really is a day out for the lads. So it's not really about pest control. And I just wonder why we're even, it's like we are kind of going down this road of saying that we can use dogs when there's actually, people working in the sector say that that's not an effective form of control, and using a marksman and sitting out is an effective and humane form of control. So I just wanted to hear your thoughts about why even dogs.
Well, there are the statistics at the time demonstrated the number of successful kills by lamping, is one example, mounted hunts. I can't remember now what these figures were, but some would say that in this society, if something can be justified, then it should be permitted. We shouldn't be stuck necessarily with only one way of doing everything we do. Now, if the argument's strong enough that the hunt is only using this as a cover for their general hunting activities, then if the public demands that hunting is outlawed, as it has, it's effectively done since 2002, then so be it. But my concern is I was never in a position to have reliable evidence. It's reliable. I mean, people will tell you about what's happened in hunts, but it's having reliable evidence about it. And you can only get that if you monitor. And if it's felt not worth doing because you have a handful of hunts that survive and they don't do all that much, and I can't remember the figures for that, then we're never going to know much more about the number of beasts that are actually killed by dogs. I don't think there is much reliable evidence about that at all.
Can I just follow up also with a question which is a supplementary on Jim Fairley's question, because I find myself quite confused every time that, Jim, you bring up the piece about flushing to guns, and that the issue is not the dogs, number of dogs, but the number of guns. But surely I don't think it's illegal to have as many guns as you want at this point.
I think that's Mr. Fairley's point, that what the concentration of the licensing authority ought to be on is the number of guns that used.
But at the moment, there's no... Is it legal to have more than two guns or 10 guns or...
There's no restriction, as far as I'm aware, on the number of licensed shotguns that could be in the hands of people, gamekeepers and farmers in the course of a foot pack outing to exterminate as many foxes as they can.
So it's not really part of this legislation. It's something that could could still be handled. That could still be done anyway, regardless of this legislation.
Yes, I think so.
Thank you.
Very, very briefly, please.
Yeah. Can I just clarify, Lord Bonamy, on the point that you made there about that alternatives of predator control should be available? Are you meaning that, on Ariane Burgess's point, that shooting and other... So shooting, but also using dogs. So lamping, which can have its welfare implications if there is obviously not a good line of sight and dense cover at night time, there is a chance that a fox could be wounded. So are you saying that... Well, I don't think I can ask you this, but is one method, in your observation, better than another in terms of welfare?
I can't answer that, I'm afraid. I really don't know enough. Lamping was just a description to me. It's not something I have seen done. But, of course, those who advocate it will tell you firmly that they eliminate the fox painlessly. I don't know. I can't remember if there was other evidence about that. You're very well served in this committee by the staff. I mean, I had a look at one of your earlier sessions and was impressed by the competence of the answers. And, of course, Mr. Dignan did work on my review and was an important element in it. So there's a lot of questions in there that he's probably far better placed to answer than me.
We are indeed lucky. We have a wealth of information to make our decisions on. Jim Fairley's got a brief supplementary.
Again, it's just clarification, going back to the point that Ariane made, where she spoke to a shepherd, and if he loses a lamb, you'll monitor it. And as a former shepherd farmer, we would call that passing trade. If you get one lamb lifted, you can live with that. Two, that's becoming a problem. Three, okay, now there is an issue. But it's that alternative methods of control, and I keep coming back to this, the preemptive strike of catching it beforehand. You've got lamping, you've got snaring, you've got den poisoning, you've got terriers, you've got dogs. Would you agree that in terms of the most welfare-efficient management of problem animals, you should have every tool in the box so long as they are managed?
That would be my general approach, but it's not a fact-based answer or knowledge-based answer. It's just a view that there's more than one way to skin a cat, then, unless there's a good reason for not allowing it, should be allowed.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Good morning, Lord Bonamy. I've just got a kind of a separate line of questioning, if that's OK. It's about the code of practice that should be developed for hunt activities around, like, notifying the police, how many guns there are, who's got the guns, how much time notification in advance needs to be made. For instance, it says here... requirements for notification in advance. So does that mean like the morning of, for instance? So in my experience, when I looked into this when I was a member of the Environment Committee in the previous session, that was a concern of mine, was what kind of notification, what should take place, and make it more factual and trackable. Is that something that you would support?
Yes, and the PACs told me, I'm not saying this is everyone, but PACs gave me information that they liaised with the police when they were going to have a hunt. And the police confirmed that happened, and there was recognised, but whether it was effectively followed practice in relation to that. And the police gave me the clear impression that they weren't too concerned about how little notice they got of changes. There can be a change in the person responsible for the hunt, for example, and it's vital you know who that is, the person that's going to be prosecuted in any of these following a hunting incident is likely to be the person controlling that particular hunt. But they were content as long as they were told. So timing wasn't a big issue. For me, if there is to be a system like that, then I would expect very definitely there should be a period of notification of all the general points that need to be notified, subject to being changed at a later stage, something like 14 days, for example. It wouldn't need to be a lengthy period. It could be less than that, because this is something that can be decided at short notice. But I have no doubt that a scheme can be worked out to do that. And there was goodwill, certainly at that time, to do it. But it also requires the police to be entirely on board on it.
And just a wee quick one, I'm aware that like some mounted packs go out like every Saturday, for instance, or every Tuesday, Saturday. So a code of practice could encompass that set of rides that were taking place. And again, that needs to be something that would be, I suppose, something that could be followed and traced, and then we know if there has changes been made, so that we know exactly how many guns, who's got the guns, who's in charge.
Things like the details of the number of guns and so on are inevitably going to be notified at short notice, but they should be noted. Guns are implements that no one should have without having authority, and no one should be out in a public place making use of one without notifying the police in advance, significantly in advance, for the police to check. So you would expect that the police would have a day or so at least to know or to make any checks they want on the personnel who are going to be using guns. But it's the detail of that, I have absolutely no doubt, can be worked out.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Lord Bonamy. The issue you touched on earlier on was, one of the many issues you touched on earlier on, was that of vicarious liability. And I think you described Scots law, or Scots lawmakers perhaps, as being reluctant to go down that route. I wonder if you just briefly set out what the concept is and how unusual it is in Scots law.
Well, it's mainly a concept. I suppose it's mainly a concept that applies in damages claims, industrial accidents, and areas of reparation for injuries caused where work is, for example, being done by a workman, and his employer will be liable for his negligence. So that's vicarious liability. I suppose I'm talking of something that could be viewed as strict liability, but it's not quite. You're only liable, you're not liable just because it happens. You're liable because you are the person who's given authority to someone else to do something. They do something wrong in the course of that, and you're held responsible. This requires work. I'm not saying, but I think it is something that can be achieved. And the rationale for it is that if somebody knows they could be at risk of prosecution, then they're likely to take extra care in deciding whether to authorise the use of their land for a particular purpose.
And finally, you mentioned that you thought that the bill was clear in its meaning as it is at the moment. I wonder, do you feel that vicarious liability is a concept that needs to be in the bill?
Well, if it's not there, then you're not going to be able to look to the person authorising someone to use his land for a hunt. If you put it in, it wouldn't directly relate or affect anything else. It would be something that would allow you to hold the person authorising another to use his land for this purpose. He could be the most peace-loving and anti-weapon individual in the world, but he would be liable for the activities of others if they were in breach of the law, or in breach, more importantly, if they were in breach of any condition of a licence.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. We have no further questions, and unless you have any closing comments...
No, I think I've spoken enough, Convener, and I hope that's helped in some way. I'm sorry my memory's not as clear as it might have been if this had been a bit closer to the time, but it's good to know that in the end of the day, action's being taken.
Thank you very much. We very much appreciate your insight and the work you did way back in 2016. It's very much appreciated. Thank you for joining this morning. That concludes our business in public, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.